This is WLBT in Jackson, Mississippi.
We're here when you need us. Come on home and see. Working together the way it ought to be. Here in Mississippi, we're one big family. You and me.
Hello, I'm Dan Modisett, General Manager of WLBT Television. We're glad to have you with us as we celebrate a half a century of broadcasting to hundreds of thousands of people in central Mississippi. This station has witnessed and presented events that have changed the course of history. At times, we've been a part of the story ourselves. Over the next hour, we'll look back at some of the more memorable events of the past five decades, some serious, some funny, but all of them are part of this station's heritage and its commitment to you then, now, and in the future. So sit back and enjoy 50 years of top stories, total coverage, and true commitment as we prepare for the next 50.
It all began in December 1953. Television had already come to the big cities, but Channel 3 brought NBC to Mississippi.
It was an exciting day, a fun day.
Bob Smathers was the station's first chief engineer. Like his staff of fellow engineers, all his experience was in radio, not this new thing called TV. But it was their job to put it on the air.
The only reception in the area in that time was some snowy reception from WDSU in New Orleans and WMC in Memphis. So we were anxious to get something on.
It was very interesting because we were in the building pulling wires and working in the trenches, putting copper grounding in the trenches before they put a roof on the building.
The main thing I recall about it is one of the very first things, somebody stuck a slide in upside down for one of an advertisement, you know, and that was our first big boo-boo, we might say, for a bunch of new fellas just getting started.
But they were off and Channel 3 was on. Among the first faces to appear was that of Woody Asaph. He had already been on the air for years at sister station WJDX Radio.
Hi, folks. I'm Woody Asaph, and I take over every morning at 7:15 with Jukebox Serenade. Now, I'm sure most of you have heard this show and know all about it. It's been on for 15 years, and it's on till 9 o'clock each morning. Now, I've been in the broadcasting business nearly 23 years. I've been here at WJDX 16 years.
Woody Asaph put this TV station on the air as an announcer. He was the sports director for a long time. He read the sports on the air every night. He did the weather as well. He was constantly on the air doing commercials where he would eat ice cream on television.
If you like peaches and cream, you'll love Sea Lily Peach Ice Cream.
Mom's favorite, big, giant 49-ounce box of Tide detergent, only 89 cents.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, we want you to meet the mayor of the city of Vicksburg, the red carpet city, Johnny Holland. Johnny.
Hey, Woody, it's sure nice to have you over here. Did you ever see such a crowd?
Isn't it wonderful?
I'm telling you, there must be at least 30 or 35,000.
Well, I estimated 35 to 40,000 people here seeing the parade tonight.
No rain in Neshoba County today, I promise you that. And I understand the Neshoba County Fair is going to wall all this in and put up Fetters air conditioners for next year to be nice and cool. Are you filming? Are you taking pictures? Well, let me know when you are, because I want to look good.
Well, it's been a beautiful day today. Looks like it's going to remain that way for a couple of more days. No fronts around us now. The front has moved away from the low off of Carolina, Virginia area, stationary through central Florida, southern tip of Texas into the west, southwest Texas. Here it is, the whole state. Weatherman says a warming trend, fair nights, partly cloudy days through Friday. Our electronic board shows a little warmer today, 89. 69 last night, 84 right now, no precipitation. Humidity is about 60%. The barometer is falling, 36. Tomorrow night, chance of rain early, then fair and cooler tomorrow night, and then Wednesday, turning fair again. Walter?
Pleasures of being news director here is to be able to interrupt any broadcast, bring the viewers something of interest. And there's something of interest tonight here, and I'd like to introduce the chief executive officer of WLBT, Mr. Frank Melton, who has some words for you.
Well, congratulations to you, Woody. I understand today you have been here 40 years.
Well, I started young.
You started young.
I started when I was a little bitty.
Well, we are all just very and extremely proud of everything that you've done. And as a very special favor to you, we're going to let you take a seat, and I'm going to finish off the weather. So why don't we go to the current temperatures and the forecast.
What's Woody say? What's the weather gonna do today? Is it gonna rain? Is it gonna shine? Woody got the weather if you got the time. What's Woody say? Pay attention. What's Woody say?
So we got married, what, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock at night?
We got the preacher out of bed.
We got the preacher out of bed and we got married.
I mean, that man came in here every single day. He hated to leave. He didn't want to go home, you know. This was the love of his life. Is it going to get colder this weekend?
Colder and rainy.
More rain, too. Right. Ooh, stay with us.
Well, even though we had a 16 last night, I just want to remind you, winter doesn't begin till tomorrow morning at 9.06 a.m. Just came in a little early, and we called up our Doppler. We called up our airport rate. And just as we're talking with Bert, everything's all clear, looking great.
43 years ago today, you did your first weathercast on WLBT.
Right, weather, sports, news, everything. We only had a handful of people here, so we did it all and did live commercials. We'd go back and forth doing live commercials, bring in cars. This was a big studio. Beautiful.
WLBT established itself early on as a source for news. People had relied mostly on radio and the newspaper until they could bring moving pictures into their living rooms. Some of our earliest film still in existence was shot at University Medical Center, where Governor Hugh White led the dedication service for the new facility in October 1955.
In the foreseeable future, postgraduate work will be offered physicians in practice. Lifelong learning is a must for the earnest physician. And postgraduate classes here will bring tremendous benefit to the physicians in general practice and to the patients in his care.
A more somber news event covered that year was the murder of Emmett Till, a black teenager visiting family in Money, Mississippi. It was said at the time that his only crime was that he whistled at a white woman. That was crime enough for some people in 1950s Mississippi. To this day, no one knows what really happened.
In 1956, Dave Garraway's Wide, Wide World on NBC did a live remote from the annual Natchez Pilgrimage using WLBT's staff.
I took a big group of our people down there, took some of our cameras, and I borrowed cameras from somebody like WDSU. We'd load cameras back and forth.
Another hospital was photographed that year, St. Dominic, which was built long before Interstate 55 ran right past it. High Street got extended in 1956. Providing a new avenue from still growing downtown Jackson.
Miss Mississippi has captured viewers' hearts since this station first signed on. But one of the biggest sensations was Marianne Mobley, who went on to become Miss America. When she returned home to Brandon with her crown in 1958, it was a 50s-style media event.
This is the first view of the plane bringing Marianne Mobley to her gigantic homecoming as Miss America. Landing in just a few moments.
Marianne Mobley has just waved to the gigantic crowd that is waiting to our hometown band. We are proud of you. We love you. You have won the hearts of all. Again, welcome to Jackson.
Thank you so much.
Bye, Marianne.
Thank you so much.
1960 began with a rare Jackson snowstorm. This is Capitol Street, with the lights of the King Edward Hotel's rooftop sign looming in the distance. That year brought major construction to central Mississippi. A huge dam project was underway to create what was then called the Pearl River Reservoir, an effort to create a reliable water supply that would ultimately spur major development along its banks. Farther south, work began on a new circus tent-inspired arena that would soon take shape as the Mississippi Coliseum. It opened with a lavish ice skating show, June 1962. Mississippi got a presidential visit from Harry Truman in 1960. The former president was in Tupelo to campaign for a future president, John F. Kennedy.
It's a great pleasure to be in Mississippi, though.
James Meredith has just arrived in the custody of federal officials and apparently making his way up to the 10th floor to register.
This is Channel 3, WLBT, Jackson, Mississippi, a Lamar Life station.
In 1962, another famous man, this one for his TV role as Andy Taylor, came to Mississippi. Andy Griffith was greeted by our cameras at the Jackson Airport.
It's a great pleasure to be in Mississippi, though. I've been here many times, though. I used to work nightclubs when I was a lot younger, and I traveled all over Mississippi. You all didn't know that, but I did.
At about the same time, an African-American man named James Meredith tried to enroll at the University of Mississippi. No black student had ever been admitted, and many people at Ole Miss and across Mississippi wanted to keep it that way. Word got out that Meredith would try to gain admission at the Ole Miss Registrar's Office in downtown Jackson. Well, WLBT took its cameras on location for a live broadcast of what happened next.
This is Hagen Thompson at the State Office Building in Jackson. James Meredith has just arrived in the custody of federal officials and apparently making his way up to the 10th floor to register. Meredith's being followed closely by news people in the company of only two federal marshals, apparently, who are brushing cameramen aside, and they're going in the front door now to the State Office Building. The crowd is booing lustily inside the Wolfolk Building. Have a crowd of several thousand inside and out.
We are waiting now for the appearance of James Meredith on the 10th floor in front of the offices of the State College Board. The activity, whatever steps the state may take now to prevent his enrollment, is expected to take place in front of this door. The crowds that have been from the offices are quiet. Here he comes now. Patrol asking us all to back up.
Just back up, everybody, please. Back up. Back up. Inside the door. Back up inside the door.
Let's get back
inside.
Let's back up. Do hereby now and finally deny you admission to the University of Mississippi.
He refused to accept the summons offered him by John Doerr of the Civil Rights Department of the Attorney General of the United States. Moving now to the elevator and out. The next move, once again, is in the hands of the government.
The story was different on September 30th, 1962. Under heavy guard and with thousands of people looking on, James Meredith walked into the Lyceum on the Oxford campus. A riot broke out in the Grove, but who started it and why are disputed to this day. When it was over, the campus was littered with burned-out cars and tear gas canisters, and two people were dead. Federal troops remained on the campus for the rest of the semester to keep order.
Back in Jackson, black citizens' struggle for equal rights was becoming more pronounced. NAACP Field Secretary Medgar Evers launched a boycott of downtown businesses in a bid to call attention to their cause.
He urged black people to boycott all the Capitol Street merchants, to have the pressure of that be felt economically. He understood that the way you change things was through the pocketbook. And he was, of course, very bright and very much ahead of his time in going that route. It's what got him killed.
Let's let the merchants down on Capitol Street feel the economic pinch.
On the night of June 4th, 1963, as Evers was returning to his home on Gine Street, he was shot in the back by a man hiding in the bushes across the street. Byron Delay Beckwith would be tried twice for the crime, but neither of the all-white juries could reach a verdict. but he was arrested again more than two decades later.
In the courtroom, Byron Delabecquith showed no visible reaction when Judge Breland Hilburn read the words guilty as charged. Spectators shouted, and Mrs. Evers covered her mouth with her hand to try and stay composed.
All I want to do is say, yay, man, girl, yay, yay, yay.
It's about time.
It's impossible to contain emotions held back for 30 years. Mrs. Merle Evers, with two of her three children beside her, thanked the prosecutors, the jury, the media, the sheriff, her family, and God. If the guilty verdict bothered Byron Delabecquith in any way, he didn't show it. He laughed and talked with sheriff's deputies as they processed him into the jail.
The eyes of the world were again on Mississippi in 1964 when three civil rights workers who'd come here to help blacks register to vote disappeared in Neshoba County. Many assumed correctly, as it turned out, the volunteers had been killed for their efforts. Their disappearance prompted a visit from Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr.
For your personal safety here?
Well, I know it's a dangerous situation and that there are difficulties, but I'm so concerned about the job to be done and the great challenges and opportunities ahead that I really don't have time to think about the possible physical dangers to my person.
Civil rights and the events that brought them to light were a problem for the station in the 1960s. The United Church of Christ claimed that WLBT did not serve all its viewers, only the white ones. The church wanted the Federal Communications Commission to suspend Lamar Life Insurance Company's license to operate Channel 3.
These monitors brought here by the United Church of Christ and the Reverend Everett C. Parker documented this station's broadcasts around the clock. And they were able to show that this station did not serve the minority community, which was about 36% at that time in the city of Jackson, that there was nothing directed at the black community, that blacks just were invisible.
I do very well remember Fred Beard having me buy seven shotguns to put in the control room, and all the bars, putting all the bars on the window, because, if you will, both sides felt they were against us. One for disseminating the news, and then one for being involved at all.
Lamar Life did make an effort to diversify once its practices were called into question. In 1969, they hired Nehemiah Flowers to work in the production department, the first minority in such a prominent position.
Growing up in Mississippi, you became acclimated to the way things were. Blacks traditionally were not on television. When they were there, probably a black minister might be doing devotions. But that's the way it was on the other television station also. So we were just glad to see a black face.
White Voices, a public affairs presentation, is a monthly program dealing with the problems in the black community. Its purpose is to bring out problems that black people feel are pertinent to brotherhood and the understanding of all men. Here again is your host, Willie Pinkston.
To begin the discussion, let's take a look at the black man's history in the political scene here in the state, specifically between the end of the Civil War and the end of Reconstruction.
And we even had the Joby Martin show that I eventually started producing.
A little Milton! Hello, Milton.
How you doing, Joby?
Welcome to the show. You'll never know how much this means to me and all of my friends in Mississippi, Louisiana, Arkansas, and all around.
This is the WLBT Sunday Night Report with Corris Collins.
Good evening. Fayette Mayor Charles Evers has become the first black candidate for governor on the Democratic ticket in Mississippi's history.
Corris Collins became the station's first black anchor, but the changes were deemed too little, too late.
Jack Hill.
I covered the hearing in 1967, which the FCC held here in Jackson to determine whether this license should be given back to the Lamar Life Insurance Company, and the commission ruled after that hearing that it should be given back to them. It was an appeal of that decision to the United States Court of Appeals in the District of Columbia that eventually resulted in the loss of the license in June of 1971.
With that, WLBT became the first station in history to lose its license for not adequately serving its audience. For 9 years, WLBT operated as a nonprofit entity under a biracial group that brought in a black general manager, William Dilday.
Did a very good job of making that transition from it being an all-white television station to one that was inclusive of minorities.
Mayor Davis arrived at the height of the demonstration and later talked with two black persons from the immediate area. This is Corris Collins, Channel 3 News on Lynch Street.
We'd like to welcome you into Black Gold, and we have some interesting guests from Jackson State University who will give you some surprising pleasure and entertainment. Welcome in.
Dogs, street dogs. Dogs of the world unite. Dancing dogs.
Hey, baby, it's showing up heavy, hip, smooth.
WLBT Channel 3 congratulates Lee King for 20 years of solid gold success with Black Gold, presented August 29th, 1992. Congratulations to you.
Well, thank you. Does that mean I get a raise, too?
Now, here is your teacher and hostess, Joyce Hughes.
Good morning. How are you? Well, that's very good. We've been waiting for you. Did you have a very nice holiday? How about your weekend? Was it good?
Yeah.
Very good. I'm pleased to hear that.
News is a very competitive business. This means the WLBT news staff works hard.
And everyone was surprised that Marsha would work for me. Because I'm a black man.
Now, we understand that a number of lives have been lost. In fact, you can see some of the automobiles that are turned over. We understand that two people were killed in one of the cars that was sitting here in the parking lot of Candlestick Park.
Mississippi's most popular TV station, WLBT Jackson.
And I had been doing some writing for an insurance company right out of college. And interviewed with Nehemiah Flowers and got the job in public affairs.
And everyone was surprised that Marsha would work for me because I'm a black man. And my advice to her was to read everything you can get your hands on and to learn everything at this station to make yourself more valuable. And apparently she used that advice.
News is a very competitive business. This means the WLBT news staff works hard to bring you, the people of Mississippi, exactly what you want to see and hear. And it's my job to report it.
Join Marsha Halford, weeknights at 10 here on WLBT.
The pinnacle of my career, when I wasn't even covering the Capitol and knew little about the powerful Capitol press corps, was when I got a tip about the most powerful Senate Appropriations guy over there, Senator Bill Bergen.
Minutes later, Bill Bergen, flanked by his wife Kathy and son, made their way to the courthouse.
That's when suddenly I'm walking down the hall trying to interview this giant of a man, and the Capitol press corps is following behind, you know. So that was a big story.
We were stopped short by a man who described himself only as an employee.
And I said, well, I just want to take a look around. No, you're not. Don't go there. And so I start walking. He starts hosing me with a water hose. That was memorable, and so we decided at that point, we better leave.
Judy Denson invites you to join her for a special Christmas presentation on Coffee with Judy. Now, here's Judy.
Good morning. We're so glad you could be with us today.
And they started talking about a show where you interview people, and I don't think they were even calling it a talk show. That probably was new terminology, but they told me they wanted me to do it, and I was so excited about that.
The first Coffee with Judy show was 1 year ago today, and since that time, many guests have come and gone, over 1,000, in fact.
Like in New York, you meet someone, and you just know this one little piece of their lives. But in the South, you know their whole story. You get the feeling of, it's a dramatic sense, I think, that grows up in you.
I want you to meet Willie Morris. He is an author. He has a new book called Yazoo, Integration in a Deep Southern Town. This is his second book. You might remember the first one as being North Toward Home. Willie Morris was born and raised in Mississippi, and he's lived in New York City for the past 8 years.
It,
really makes one feel good to see that this kind of interest has been generated in one's hometown.
Since the beginning of time, the giving of gifts has been the accepted way for man to express friendship, kindness, and love.
Sleigh bells ring, are you listening? In the lane, snow is glistening. A beautiful sight, we're happy tonight. Walking in a winter wonderland. Gone away is the bluebird, here to stay is the new bird. He sings a love song as we go along, walking in a winter wonderland.
Long before there were meteorologists on TV, Judy Moon did the weather. She's still remembered for a 10 o'clock forecast she delivered in January 1969.
I had said it was a little stormy outside, not a whole lot going on. Went home, that's 10:30 at night. And the next morning, a tornado hits Hazelhurst about daylight. So that night at 6, I'm sitting at my TV ready to watch the 6 o'clock news.
At least 31 persons were killed and hundreds injured today as tornadoes roared through three Mississippi counties. 12 fatalities were reported in the Hazelhurst area, including two who died en route to Jackson hospitals.
They found this little lady, and he said, well, tell me, what happened? She said, it was awful, it was terrible. He said, Herbert, my husband, he hung his britches on the bedpost before he went to bed.
But he wouldn't come out the house. He said, I want to get my pants. Wait, Mama, I want to get my pants. I said, Herbert, forget about your pants and come on. I said, don't you hear the wind?
And he said, well, didn't you have any warning that it was coming?
But there was no warning that this was about to happen. It just came and hit.
Yes, that's right.
She was watching the weather the night before.
Because when the weather come on last night at 10:30, Judah Moon said it would be a thunderstorm. And rain.
Miss Judy Moon didn't say nothing about no tornado. She said there might be thunder showers and rain, but she didn't say nothing about no tornado.
They didn't say anything about a tornado.
Not a week of my life has gone by that somebody hasn't mentioned that to me, and it's usually more than one time a week.
As far as the shopping center itself is concerned, it is completely destroyed.
I was asleep. I think I had probably worked the morning shift that day, and my wife woke me up. The telephone was out. But Keith, myself, and I don't know who else, had two-way radios in our car. So I went out to the car and called the station. And then they told me what had happened. And then, of course, everybody went to the station.
This will give you an idea of the terrific damage this tornado, which hit South Jackson this afternoon at about 4:30, did to Candlestick Park. Right at the moment, it is about 6 o'clock, a little after 6 o'clock.
I'd never seen damage like that before. That was an F5 tornado, which is the highest rating, you know, on the Fujita scale for a tornado. And it was just unbelievable that something could spread debris like that thing did and just completely wipe out that shopping center.
We understand that a number of lives have been lost. In fact, you could see some of the automobiles that are turned over. We understand that two people were killed in one of the cars that was sitting here in the parking lot of Candlestick Park.
It toppled a 1,600-foot plus tower at the site of the present tower, southeast of Raymond. Scored a direct hit on it, laid it out across a cow pasture.
I just can't believe that a tower is going to fall, a 1,000-foot tower is just going to fall. But it literally crumbled like a pretzel and came all to pieces.
Channel 3 was back on the air the next morning with a backup tower, but it would face the same situation again 30 years later, only this time there was no storm.
Investigators spent today combing through the wreckage of the tower which fell Thursday morning. They're attempting to determine the exact cause of the collapse, and there's no estimate on when that will be known, if ever. OSHA has ordered that the downed tower be left in place and not disturbed at all until the investigators finish their work.
From its early days, Jackson was always vulnerable to flooding. One of the first floods captured on news film was in 1961, before levees were in place to protect the fairgrounds and the new Coliseum from the Pearl River. But even the levees couldn't hold back the Easter flood of 1979.
When Saturday dawned, it was obvious that the flood of 79 was much more serious than anyone could have expected. As the sun set Saturday evening, the city's transportation, communication, and water facilities were all being threatened. The Pearl began to spill over the top of the levees by late morning. Because of the spillover and the fear of breaks in the levee, Interstate 55 was closed to all traffic from Canton south to Crystal Springs. In many cases, the water was waist deep. In some of the hardest hit areas, the only way to travel was by boat. In Northeast Jackson, the already bad situation got worse. By the afternoon, homes in the River Road area were underwater, except for the rooftops.
Over the years, WLBT has captured stunning images of other weather-related disasters. Among the worst was Hurricane Camille in 1969.
Fears have been expressed by some that with destruction like this on the Mississippi Gulf Coast, this area may never be rebuilt to what it once was. But city officials on the coast don't agree with that idea, although it may take a little while before the rebuilding becomes a reality. Mayor, what about rebuilding Gulfport?
Of course we're going to rebuild Gulfport. They rebuilt San Francisco and they rebuilt Chicago after the fire. It'll take time. We've had a tremendous amount of damage along the beachfront and the port. We're working now to get that straightened out. We've got to get these ships out that were sunk. We've got to unload them and move them out, and that's taking place right now. I don't think there's any question but we will rebuild this city. It hadn't been destroyed.
Less threatening but almost as rare in Mississippi, snow. This is WLBT's studio on Jefferson Street in 1968. Predicting bad weather was never an exact science, but it got a lot better when WLBT purchased a state-of-the-art radar system in 1970.
Watch radar weather reports on WLBT, where the radar is.
It became known as Radar 3, and every year on Christmas Eve, it detected more than just bad weather.
Let's jack that power up, guys, and see if we can get old Santa to come in. He's supposed to pass, this is about right, 6:23, make his first pass across to Jackson. Man, he's moving.
That's amazing, you know, modern technology.
Well, I've always said, we got the radar, and every year these guys work on it. They do a little extra effort, and they jack the power up, and they can just reach out and get it.
You invade my privacy this way 6 months from now, I'll whip your ass.
It was Saturday afternoon from 5 to 6, and it was a live show.
And Alan came on and talked about this being the first color broadcast emanating from Mississippi soil, and it was.
WLBT, Channel 3, Jackson, Mississippi.
One of the most popular shows during those early days was a local version of American Bandstand. They called it Teen Tempos, and it premiered February 1957. Its creator, Chuck Allen.
And I knew there was a tremendous amount of talent, so we devised this format to show not only the kids dancing, but also performing. And then also we always had a teen report, which was a discussion of the activities at the school or the teen center that was on the air that particular day. And it turned out to be very, very popular.
One of this station's biggest technical revolutions came in 1967 when it edged out the competition to become the first Mississippi station to broadcast in color.
They had one RCA they were able to get here and get in place, and they knew they were about to be beaten, LBT knew. So they put Alan B. on at 9 o'clock on a Sunday night, introducing the premiere movie that they would run in those days. And Alan came on and talked about this being the first color broadcast emanating from Mississippi soil, and it was.
Some of the first images shot for the new color film processor came from Capitol Street, which was still a thriving retail district in the late 60s. But big changes were coming to the West End.
Well, I made a very hard decision today, and that was to close the King Edward Hotel, which has been a tradition in Jackson and has been the scene of some of the most outstanding events in the history of Mississippi for approximately 67 years. We have made many studies and come to the conclusion that the King Edward can no longer be operated as a profitable prop in the hotel business, therefore prompted this decision.
And then all of a sudden comes this Jackson Mall, which was the first mall built out on Woodrow Wilson there. Still there, of course, is the medical mall now, Woodrow Wilson and Bailey Avenue. And then came Metro Center after that, and then came North Park Mall. Well, of course, all three of those malls just decimated Capitol Street.
But in the late 60s, access to downtown and to other states was improving with construction of the interstate system.
For the first time, people who lived in North Jackson had four-lane, interstate-controlled access highway to come downtown. What a revolution that was. Instead of having to come down North State Street or Old Canton Road with all the stoplights.
You can now travel on a beautiful four-lane highway all the way from Jackson to Meridian.
I take this occasion to announce to the people of Mississippi that I will be a candidate for governor in the elections this year.
The legacy of William Winter is, of course, a tremendous legacy to this state.
I think we are on the brink of ridding ourselves of the hang-ups that we have had in the past and have clung to too long.
William Winter was a serious, studious person who was very goal-oriented. His Education Reform Act was something he was going to get done, and he finally did in 1982.
With passage of a state-supported kindergarten program, an effective compulsory education attendance law, and a $1,000 across-the-board raise for teachers, Governor William Winter visited the members of the House and Senate this morning, saying they've made a break with the old do-nothing spirit that has held Mississippi back.
It will be recorded as one of the most significant things that any legislature has ever done in this state for the children of Mississippi.
My favorite governor to cover as a news person was Kirk Fordyce. By far, because you could get Kirk Fordyce to talk about anything that was happening in the world today. I respected and appreciated that as a news person more than any governor I covered.
It was the reunion of the class of 52 in 1992 where he was reunited with his junior high school sweetheart, Ann.
I regret to this day that he's angry at me because of the story I did about him and his divorce.
This picture of Governor Kirk Fordyce with his childhood sweetheart, Ann Garber Crisson, was taken at the Memphis airport last Sunday night by a Memphis news reporter. They had just returned from a vacation together in France. The reporter recognized them on a flight from Atlanta to Memphis.
It was a story I didn't have any choice but to do. It was out there, and he became flagrant in the way he flaunted the fact that he wanted to get a divorce while he was still the governor of this state, and that's legitimate public news.
This was Governor Kirk Fordyce's reaction when we tried to ask him about it at his Madison home Monday.
You invade my privacy this way 6 months from now, I'll whip your ass. You have no damn business playing these games.
I'm on a public street, Governor.
Okay, you're on a public street.
By 1971, WLBT had amassed a huge collection of news film from its nearly 20 years on the air. This old stuff took up a lot of space and just didn't keep well. So the entire collection of all the major news events of the 50s, 60s, and 70s was sent down the street to the Mississippi Department of Archives and History. It's still there today in the new William F. Winter Building on North Street. Now, historians, students, and even movie producers use WLBT news film every day.
On our national map tonight, that cold front is currently stretching all the way from Texas.
WLBT, home of the news professionals.
And news continues to be the hallmark of WLBT. More Mississippians watch the news on WLBT than any other station. Now here's a look at some of the other major news stories we've covered.
All of this happened after two blacks were killed on the night of May 14th by gunfire, one in front of this dormitory, Alexander Hall, and the other in front of Benjamin F. Roberts Dining Hall.
For years, the South was faced with a perplexing question. How to integrate its schools by the use of court-ordered busing.
It was a Southern dilemma, and the national press watched and filed their reports. Today, it is a national dilemma, and the press is now looking in its own backyard. We have decided to help them look, with the hope that we can better understand ourselves and our nation, as Channel 3 presents the first in a two-part series on Boston school busing, next on Probe.
Here we go, Boston, here we go.
The whole place looks more like a concentration camp with armed guards, more so than a school.
A position of power, however, is oftentimes racked with controversy and conflict. And nowhere is this perhaps more evident than with State Senator Bill Bergen of Columbus, chairman of the Senate Appropriations Committee and a member of the state legislature for 20 years. As such, Bergen is in a position where he also serves in other governmental capacities, such as sitting on the Budget and Accounting Commission, which decides how much the state will spend each year.
This is Dennis Smith with Pro.
This is a WLBT Sports Special, a report on Ole Miss's Archie Manning. Here is WLBT WJDX Sports Director Dick Timms.
Good evening. Last Saturday in Oxford at Hemingway Stadium in a football game against the University of Houston, a record crowd saw this typical Archie Manning pass play. Most people naturally followed the ball. When the pass fell incomplete, this is what everybody in the stands looked back upfield to see. Archie Manning, in falling, had broken his arm, his left forearm, and by now you know the rest of the story. Today in his hospital room in Memphis, we asked Archie what his first thoughts were when he was told that the break would necessitate surgery.
Of course, it was very disappointing. I guess the most disappointing thing was when they told me that I'd be out for the rest of the year.
After visiting with Archie and his doctor, we took a trip over to Methodist Hospital, where head coach John Vault is confined for a further test as a result of his recent heart attack.
Well, I feel just fine, and I feel like I'm loafing. I feel like I ought to be out on the field, and I don't see any reason for them keeping me up here as long as they are.
TV3, WLBT, Jackson, Mississippi. This is a Channel 3 News 6 o'clock report with Walter Sadler, Charlie McAlexander, and Woody Asaph.
This was the day that Republican hopefuls Ronald Reagan and Richard Schweiker came to Mississippi. Their avowed purpose, to woo this state's 30 delegate votes at the Kansas City GOP convention.
Reagan's trip is a carbon copy of his last visit to Mississippi. There was handshaking at the airport and a speech for the relatively small crowd. But there was one major exception. The presidential contender brought along his controversial running mate, Senator Richard Schweiker.
President Jimmy Carter first touched down on Mississippi soil at 5:18 yesterday afternoon when Air Force One splashed onto the runway of the Jackson Airport. A wet but jubilant crowd was on its feet as Carter emerged from the aircraft and made his way toward the crowd under the protection of a clear plastic umbrella. Then it was time to press the flesh, so he made his way along the rope as the admirers stretched over each other for that one touch of the president's hand.
Fannie Lou Hamer began her life's journey in 1917 in the thick, fertile mud of Montgomery County, Mississippi. 60 years later, after struggles that brought her from the cotton fields to national limelight, Fannie Lou Hamer now returns to that same Mississippi soil. This is Gary Whitaker reporting from Ruleville, Mississippi.
WLBT, Jackson, Mississippi. From Mississippi's number one news team, this is the WLBT 10 p.m. report. Bert Case with news. Michael Rubenstein with sports. Maggie Wade with weather.
Good evening. An earthquake centered in California's San Joaquin Valley has caused major destruction tonight.
I hope rainy days and Tuesdays don't get you down. Maggie's weather is next.
On our national map tonight, that cold front is currently stretching all the way from Texas. It moves into Arkansas, moves up through Tennessee, Ohio, then moves up into the Great Lakes region, and it's associated with several low-pressure systems.
Kate served as Jackson City Commissioner in the late 1960s and early 1970s. Funeral services are scheduled for Tuesday in Jackson. Authorities say Kate's Honda Civic was engulfed in flames when it was spotted by a passerby on this rural Madison County road. Kate's badly burned body was pulled from the car after firefighters extinguished the blaze.
With his wife by his side and a smile on his face, 42-year-old Judge Reuben Anderson made history as he was sworn in as the first black judge to serve on the state Supreme Court. Witnesses tell us that a truck hauling a hay baler collided with a small car trailing the walkers, hurling the car into the group of sorority sisters. The Highway Patrol says the accident happened at about 2:30 p.m., about 5 miles west of Oxford on Mississippi 6.
The crew from Unsolved Mysteries spent 4 days in Jackson talking with local officials investigating the Heron kidnapping. Members of the Heron family hope someone in the television audience will provide a clue to the whereabouts of 73-year-old Annie Laurie Heron.
The state is covered with ice from the Tennessee line to below Jackson. School was called off in many communities and may well be canceled again tomorrow.
Good evening, I'm Marcia Pollack.
And I'm Howard Ballou, and Governor Ray Mabus is with us tonight. Governor, obviously it's pretty serious or you wouldn't be here.
People here said remembering Sister Thea Bowman will be easy. Church officials said they'll never forget her.
I don't know what the purpose of this meeting is.
Dr. Bishop Knox arrived at JPS headquarters at 4:45 this afternoon. Knox's termination stems from him allowing student Kim Fales to read a prayer over the school's intercom system 3 days straight last week.
About 6 this morning, firefighters were called to the Landmark restaurant where people have been dining since April of 1948. The building was engulfed in flames and totally lost.
But this is George Elementary School at Winter and Gallatin Streets. Here, the future seems to be in the hands of prostitutes and drug dealers because police, politicians, and the rest of us have been looking the other way for a very long time.
From your number one news team, this is the WLBT 5 p.m. report with Maggie Wade, Bert Cage, and Woody Asaph with weather.
I'm gonna blow up the place. And he was just running around with the gun in his hand and he was kept putting bullets in.
Two firemen are dead, four are injured, possibly a fifth, and the casualty count doesn't end. We go first to Maggie Wade at the downtown Jackson Fire Station. Maggie, what can you tell us?
Well, Bert, it was complete chaos, very tragic. We've had some family members to come down here to the Central Fire Station.
Doctors at University Medical Center say Governor Kirk Fordyce received injuries in the crash of his sports utility vehicle that is now posing a danger to his life.
16-year-old Luke Woodham, distraught over a breakup with his girlfriend, strolled into an area crowded with students at Pearl High School, pulled a rifle from under his trench coat, and opened fire. Two students were killed.
The case went to the jury around 11 a.m. When court reconvened about 3 hours later, the stormy weather had cut off electricity. In the darkened courtroom, Luke Woodham stared at the jurors, some of them sobbing, as they delivered their decision. Guilty.
The zoom on the camera on the front is 20-1 with a 2x extender which can frame the rear of a car from 1,000 feet. It is a state-of-the-art machine.
Well, it's time now for Mississippi Window, and here's Golia.
For the last time, I'll say, we'll go back to the news desk after this. I'm Golia Revis.
Well, he loved the Crimson Tide, and his favorite movie was A Coal Miner's Daughter, but most of all, Ed Fiddler loved life. Tonight we look back at our former colleague who passed away this morning in New Orleans at the age of 39.
So we heard the reports that the White House was a target actually yesterday, and for that to be verified today, all I can do is count my blessings and just thank the Lord.
More than 300 people celebrated the historic announcement at the state capitals.
When fully operational, the plant will directly employ up to 4,000 people.
And that, my friends, is the bottom line.
So, after 50 years, what do we do for an encore? How about another 50? Our future promises as many revolutions as our past. Next on the list is a new high-definition channel.
The universe has changed since 1953, and so has WLBT. This building is full of professionals dedicated to providing what you've come to expect from Channel 3. Good shows, and of course, the best news, sports, and weather coverage in Mississippi.
Thank you for joining us on this trip down memory lane. Let's do it again in 2053.
We're here when you need us. Come on home and see. Working together the way it ought to be. Here in Mississippi, we're one big family. You and me, WLBT.
you and me, and WLBT.